My name is Abelardo Valdez. I served as U.S. Ambassador and Chief of Protocol for the White House under President Carter from 1979 to 1981. Before that, I served as a military social aide to President Lyndon Johnson from 1965 to 1967. Well, I came to Washington immediately after graduating from Texas A&M, where I was a member of the Corps of Cadets and was commissioned as a lieutenant upon graduation. So my first duty station was at Fort Belvoir, Virginia, here near Washington. And a few weeks after reporting there, I was selected to be one of the military social aides to the president. Subsequent to my service in the military, I attended law school at Baylor Law School and Harvard Law School and the Hague Academy of International Law in the Netherlands. I practiced law in Washington prior to my appointment as first as administrator of the U.S. Agency for International Development for Latin America in the first 2 years of the Carter administration. And during the last 2 years, I was appointed chief of protocol for the White House with the rank of ambassador. Well, the military aides play a very important role in the protocol of the White House, and so they are unofficial assistants, if you will, to the chief of protocol in the design of the event and the execution of the plans for that event, be it a state dinner or some other official function that the president is hosting. Of course, the chief of protocol is the president's personal representative to every head of state that comes to visit at the White House, and is the chief advisor to the president on all matters of diplomatic protocol. So he has the overall responsibility. But the military aides work very closely with the social secretary at the White House, as well as the chief of protocol, in the conduct of these very important official events that involve not only foreign heads of state, but also with the Congress, the judiciary, and distinguished people from all over the country who come to the White House as guests of the president. Probably the most public events that with the chief of protocol is seen is in the arrival ceremonies on the South Lawn of the White House for every state visitor. There's a very colorful and impressive ceremony that is provided at those events by the military services. Usually with guests in attendance, the guests of the president who come to witness the event and welcome the state visitor. The chief of protocol introduces the visitor to the president upon his arrival at the red carpet there on the South Lawn, and subsequently accompanies him into the White House. And if there's a reception inside the White House, the chief of protocol introduces all the guests to the president, and he's there as to assist the president in any way that is necessary throughout the event. The military aides, of course, are a very important part of those ceremonies, not only the troops that are in the ceremonial part, but in the escorting of guests in the White House and serving as assistant host for the president to his guests. The president cannot get around to every guest at these events, and so therefore he relies on the military social aides to assist him and make sure that the guests feel welcome, that they feel that they've been well received. And it's a very important part of the administration's role. In the beginning of our history, George Washington and the early presidents were particularly concerned about protocol because they were a new government, a small country at that time, not very sophisticated, and they wanted to make an impression on all the ministers of the European nations that were represented in Washington. So George Washington himself gave a lot of time and attention to the details of protocol. And his military aide was Colonel David Humphreys, who had served in the Revolution in Washington. And once Washington became president, he was his military aide at the White House, in New York, actually, where the first administration was headquartered. And in that role, Colonel Humphreys served not only as military aide, but also as military social aide and sort of chief of protocol at the events that President Washington held in his residence, not only for the ministers of the foreign governments, but also for the American guests. Washington knew he was setting a precedent in how a president conducted himself in public at these public events. And so he was very attentive to detail exactly what would happen. And Colonel Humphreys was indispensable in helping him to carry out those events in a very successful manner and give a very positive impression of the new government. Well, of course, I mentioned that for state visits, the ceremonial arrival at the White House is very important. By the way, prior to President Kennedy, these arrival ceremonies were held at the airport where the state visitor would arrive, at either Andrews Air Force Base or National Airport then. President Kennedy wanted to make a much more impressive arrival ceremony, and so he shifted that ceremony to the White House in the South Lawn of the White House with the mansion in the background. And of course, it was all the difference in the world. It looks much more spectacular sight. It gives the visiting state head of state the impression that this is really a very impressive arrival ceremony. That's one thing that changed with President Kennedy's administration. The other things are that the president receives every ambassador, foreign ambassador, who is appointed to Washington to represent their country. And there is a ceremony every few months for new ambassadors who are escorted from their embassy to the White House by one of the State Department aides. But then when they arrive at the White House, the military aides escort them into the Oval Office where the Presidential of Credentials, as it's called, ceremony is held. And basically the ambassador presents a letter from his head of state indicating, confirming that he is the official representative of that government before the United States government, before the president. And it's a brief ceremony, but it's a very impressive ceremony. And it makes a very positive impression on the new ambassador. A lot of people don't see that ceremony because it's all held inside the White House, but it's a very important, and that's a tradition of diplomacy that has existed for many centuries, actually, and comes from the European form of protocol. Other events usually involve not only a state dinner for the visitor on one of the evenings that he is here, but also there's usually entertainment after the dinner. And some of the top artists, musical artists, literary artists, others perform at the White House for the state visitor, and that's a sort of the grand finale of a state dinner. Of course, the president also hosts many people from around the country for different events. Every year there's a congressional reception where members of Congress are feted at the White House, and also the judiciary, the members of the Supreme Court and other members of the judiciary are invited annually to be received by the president. Those are very important events. So the military aides are assisting in all of those events, even those that are purely domestically oriented. And they're really indispensable to ensuring that the event is carried out gracefully and gives a very positive impression to the visitors. This is very important for the president to be assured of that. The other thing is that in the state dinners, one of the military social aides also serves as the commander of the color guard. Typically, a head of state coming in for a state dinner is escorted upstairs to the private quarters where the president and the first lady receive them and their official party. And they have a brief reception, and following that brief reception, one of the military social aides and the color guard go up with the colors, the presidential colors and the American flag, and they lead the party down the grand staircase to the first floor, where they are usually photographed there by the media, the press, and then they move over to the red carpet in the center of the first floor, and facing towards the East Room, proceed to walk into the East Room, and the Chief of Protocol is there also to arrange the receiving line and to help with the introductions. It's a very impressive ceremony as they enter the East Room. The Hail to the Chief is being played for the President, and it's a moment that really makes an impression on every American, because you see the majesty of the colors, and which represent the majesty of the country. The military aides during that part of the ceremony are helping to arrange the receiving line in the order of protocol for the official party, as well as the American officials, and then all the civilian guests of the president. Usually 150 to 190 guests attend a state dinner. There's been a lot of experience in the Office of Protocol, the staff, as well as in the White House. It's done very well, and it's planned well in advance. But let me tell you why this is important. As I mentioned, in the early years of the Republic, President Washington and President Adams were particularly keen to sort of follow the more or less the protocol of the European courts, which is a very formal manner. President Jefferson, our third president, had served as ambassador to France and was very familiar with the protocol of the French court. However, he was a true Democrat. He didn't believe in titles. He thought even Mr. should be removed from addressing people. And when he became president, he basically changed all the rules that Washington and Adams had established for events at the White House. And he said that the rule would be of a Virginia gentleman hosting his guests at his home, and that it would be basically first come, first serve, that there would be no order of precedence in protocol. And of course, that was before the Vienna Convention, which established rules of precedence and so forth. And basically, the country that had the most guns was felt like they deserved the first order of precedence at formal events. But Jefferson changed all that, and the few ministers of foreign governments that were here, I think there were five or six, were thrown into a tizzy, because all of a sudden they didn't know where they were supposed to go, who's supposed to walk through the door first, who's supposed to be escorted into the state dining room. And in fact, in the first event that President Jefferson held, he escorted Dolly Madison, the wife of the Secretary of State, on his arm into the dining room and set her on his right, instead of the British minister, who felt that his wife should have been escorted in and set at the president's right, since he was considered himself the ranking guest. Well, this event caused great consternation, and this minister, Anthony Mary, wrote a famous letter back to his foreign minister saying that last night His Majesty's representative in Washington was basically insulted by the President of the United States, and that he was not given the proper precedence at this event. And this confusion came about, continued, and other ministers were complaining about it. And finally, after the second term of Jefferson, the rules were changed back to the formal protocol and the order of precedence. Secretary Madison insisted that that should be the way to conduct these events, but it initially created a great deal of confusion. So it shows you why protocol is important. Now, after the Vienna Convention, after the Napoleonic Wars, it was established the order of precedence that the ambassador who serves, who has the longest length of service in a post, has the first order of precedence, and so on. You're ranked by the order of service at a particular country. And so that made it easy. So protocol is, in a way, it's formality, but it's formality for a purpose, so that everybody knows who ranks where and who sits where. And if everybody knows the rules, then things flow smoothly. And so that's why those rules were established, and that's the chief of protocol has a responsibility for making sure that that is done correctly. We never, as far as I can remember, had no problems with the seating arrangements and so forth. However, when I was chief of protocol, I remember an event that was really very, it's amusing now, but it was very serious then. As I mentioned, when the arrival ceremony, the president, the visiting president or king or other head of state is driven in the limousine into the White House grounds on the South Lawn and stops in front of the red carpet. They're just across from the diplomatic entrance of the White House, the South entrance, and the entire military honor guard is there. There are 100 members of the media, photographers from all over the world, the White House photographers and so forth, the media. And president of Kenya was arriving that day, and his limousine approached the red carpet, and then a soldier of the old guard kneeled down to open the door to let out the visitor. And as he did, the driver also unlocked or locked accidentally the doors to the limousine. And so he couldn't open the door. And President Carter and I were there waiting breathlessly for it to be opened. And finally, when we realized that that was not gonna happen, maybe 30 seconds or so, and we heard a little kind of beginning of laughter in the media stand, the president had the good sense to say, well, let's go around the other side. And so we took out the visitor on the left side of the limousine and saved ourselves even more embarrassment. But he actually was very cool in thinking of that. I myself was sort of half paralyzed there because that never happened before. You know, it usually happens very smoothly. The door is open. I introduce the visitor to the president, and then they proceed to the stand where they'll give their speeches. So that's one, I like to say, that's the kind of event where a chief of protocol is decorated with the order of the boot. I had another colleague who had a similar experience with Queen Elizabeth when she came to the White House and had a similar ceremony, and everything went well up to the time that the president gave his welcoming speech. This is outside the South Lawn and the stand, and then the Queen proceeded to the lantern to the stand, and it was too high so that all you could see was her hat behind the lantern, and the press made a big to-do about it, and the chief of protocol then, Ambassador Joseph Reed, the next day issued a press release, a humorous press release, as well, I thought it was such a beautiful hat, I wanted to showcase it. So that's how you handle that. You know, many people come to the White House for the first time at one of these official events, be it a state dinner or some other official event. They've never been to the White House, and so when they come in, they are both impressed and to some extent intimidated. They're nervous. They want to do the right thing. And so they rely on the military aides, military social aides, as well as the protocol people who are there helping to direct them to where they're supposed to go, to assure them that they are in the right place, and to converse with them and put them at ease. And so that I know that every president wants his guests to be attended in a very positive and respectful manner, and knowing that he cannot always get around to every one of the guests to greet them other than in the receiving line, he relies heavily on his chief of protocol, the social secretary, and the military social aides at those events. Yes, well, obviously with the official party, you know in advance who they are, and we do have a list of the guests. But in fact, one of the military aides usually stands to the left of the chief of protocol, who is standing right next to the president, and he gets the name of the guest. The guest is supposed to give the name, and other aides are telling the guest, as you approach, please give your name. And then the military aide passes that name on to the chief of protocol, who introduces to the president, says, Mr. President, this is Mr. Jones, or Mr. and Mrs. Jones. Now, sometimes you have guests who do know the president personally, and they feel that they don't have to give the name. And that has happened. They say, well, no, the president knows me. I don't, you know. And of course, that puts the military aide and the chief of protocol, you know, in a quandary. Because what are they going to say? This is your old friend? So that happens very occasionally, but it does happen. Well, usually, you know, one of the most intimate settings, of course, is, as I said, prior to the state dinner, that the visitors are escorted up to the second floor, the private quarters of the pref to the foreign visitor, and so that all happens in a very intimate, relaxed venue. Usually, there are not more than about a dozen people at that particular part of the ceremony. And then, of course, when the visitor comes in for the official meetings at the in the Oval Office, he's escorted. And many times, it's just the two presidents meeting. Occasionally, if an interpreter is required, an interpreter would be there. Or occasionally, one aide, one of the national security aides or State Department official would accompany at those meetings. And those are very, very intimate and confidential discussions that are held in the White House. Sometimes there are bigger meetings with the whole official party and the visitor, as well as members of the cabinet or national security officials, Department of State officials in the cabinet room are held. I would be there, yes. Basically, the chief of protocol accompanies the visitor, the visiting head of state, everywhere from the minute he arrives to the minute he departs. And sometimes it includes travel around the United States. We go to various cities. I had the pleasure of escorting the Prime Minister of Ireland, Jack Lynch, to five cities around the country. And because the chief of protocol is the personal representative of the President of the United States to that head of state. So all that planning for those visits is all falls on the protocol people, and of course working very closely with the Secret Service officials as well. In every city, I think in most of the cities there were Irish American mayors, in Chicago and Houston and New York, and the Irish American community was very well represented at those events. So it was a very festive, almost like a family event. Also we went to New Orleans. So it was a great trip. I enjoyed it. It's a lot of work, but very enjoyable to be able to escort a foreign head of government and to see how Americans react to that, and how they're impressed by the visit. So that's all very important for the relations between our countries. And that, unfortunately, now because of the press of time, those kinds of visits are rare. Back in the 70s and 80s, there was more of those kinds of visits. Usually now the visitor comes to Washington and usually for 2 days and then returns. Many a time, visiting heads of state, heads of government will come in just for a meeting with the president. One meeting, a lunch at the White House and a meeting, and then they fly right back out. I saw that happen many times when I was chief of protocol. And those are called official working visits. They're not the state visit, which involves all the other ceremonial aspects, but are very important meetings. And with the advent of the jet aircraft, why that's those trips are possible, and the head of government can be back the next day at his office or her office. Well, I was actually assigned to Fort Belvoir as an engineer officer, Corps of Engineers officer, and I commanded a company that was training enlisted men in the engineer corps. And so I had that job, which usually took about two-thirds of my time, and then the other third and plus was serving as an aide at the White House. So you're doing dual duty, and it's you're out here in the real world in a way, and then you walk into the White House, and it feels like you're in a very special world, very unique, so much history oozing from the walls of that mansion, and then the many distinguished visitors who come there. It's an amazing experience, and it really has influenced, that experience has influenced all of my career and my life, because when I was serving as a military social aide, I looked around and I saw that the people who were advising the president were either lawyers or economists, and I decided there at the age of 23, 24 that's what I wanted to do. And that's what convinced me to study law, first at the Baylor Law School. And I went on to get a master's of law and international law at Harvard Law School. In between, I attended the Hague Academy of International Law, which is actually part of the World Court in the Netherlands, because I got very interested in international law and international relations as a result of that tour at the White House. So when I graduated, I returned to Washington and I started my career in working at two government organizations that had been recently created and that involve international law. And then I went into private practice with two former congressmen, one of whom I had met during my tour of the White House, who was from Texas, a great friend of mine, Congressman Graham Purcell, also a former judge. And he and his partner, another member of Congress, Orville Hansen, invited me to become the junior partner of their new law firm. And that's what I was doing when President Carter came to office. And friends of mine had been very involved in the campaign and subsequently the transition to the new administration. And they were recruiting talent for the administration. They asked me if I would be interested in serving in some capacity. And I said, well, yeah, I'd be interested in the State Department. And as a result, I received two invitations, if you will, to serve at State. One was to be a Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Latin America, and the other one to be the Administrator of the U.S. Agency for International Development for Latin America. That's the position that I selected because it was very substantive and also was the highest ranking positions between the two. And so I did that work for 2 years, traveled throughout Latin America administering the aid program in 18 countries. We had more than 1,000 employees at that time, a budget of about $500 million. And I was very interested in economic development, and having overcome a great deal of economic poverty in my youth, I wanted to help people who were in that situation, and it gave me a lot of satisfaction. And then 2 years later, out of the blue, I received a call from the White House Chief of Staff saying that the President would like to appoint me Ambassador and Chief of Protocol for the White House. And I was really floored. I had really been interested in being an ambassador, but I wanted to be assigned to a country. This is what the President wanted me to do, and I said, fine, if that's what he wants to do, I'll be happy to serve. And that gave me basically a window to the leadership of the world, because we had some 50 heads of state who visited during the 2 years I was there, either in formal state visits or in these official private visits, which last a day or two. And in all of them, I was involved in every one, and I got to talk and travel with these people, these prime ministers, the presidents, the kings and queens, to be in very intimate settings with them, which is quite an education. They're people with tremendous responsibilities, but they're human beings. So they one thing that came through was that they're just like you and me in terms of their humanity. Very interesting people. Well, I traveled with, for example, with Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher between first in to Williamsburg, where I used to arrive the heads of state in Williamsburg overnight and get over the jet lag and then fly into Washington. And subsequently went up to New York, where she had meetings. I remember flying in a helicopter with her from New Jersey, where we'd gone to visit an Exxon facility. She was a chemist. Her background was in chemistry, and she wanted to visit that facility. And then we flew into New York after the sun was setting, and got a spectacular view of the city as we landed there. I also had the honor of receiving Pope John Paul II. Actually, he was my second visitor. My first visitor was the President of Mexico. So for a Mexican-American Catholic, it seemed like the stars were aligned. But the visit of the Pope was really a tremendous event. He was the first Pope ever to visit the White House as a state visitor, because he is the Vatican State is actually a state. So he's a head of government as well as the religious head of the Catholic Church. And initially we went up to Boston with Mrs. Carter and a delegation of congressmen, senators to receive him in Boston. And he did his pastoral tour around the country and then came for the official state visit to the White House. And it was a spectacular event. I had never seen so many people for an arrival of a state visitor. We had several thousand people seated in the South Lawn. There were people seated in the front lawn, and there were some 30 or more governors and another 30 or so members of the Senate and the House. And it was a very beautiful day. It was very joyful. I remember that prior to the Pope's arrival at the White House, before leaving the embassy, his embassy on Massachusetts Avenue, there was a crowd that formed around the embassy to say hello to the Pope. And so he came out on a balcony and he greeted them by just raising his hands very gently up and down, palms open. And I was sitting in the White House mess with the President's assistants. And one of them said, well, I wish I could get the President to be able to get that kind of reaction. So he made quite an impression on me and on everybody that he met. He was truly a remarkable person, and I was very honored to be involved in that event. I'll mention one event where the unexpected happened. As I mentioned, all the details of a visitor planned down to the last second, and we had discussed with the officials of the Vatican Embassy here about the arrival ceremony in Boston and how usually in order to be in position to introduce at the bottom of the stairs of the aircraft, the Chief of Protocol escorts the Pope or the visitor. But in order to do so, I had to step forward. I had to be a little bit in advance. And so when the Pope got out of the plane, we stood at the top of the stairs and he was waving at the crowd there at the airport. And then I said, Your Holiness, if I may lead the way. And then his advance man said, no, no one goes before the Pope. And so then I thought to myself, well, how am I going to introduce, because I knew what he was going to do when he got down to the bottom of the stairs. He has this tradition of kissing the ground. And if you will see pictures of that, I'm on the last step, and I'm trying to figure out how am I going to get over to the left without stepping on his robe in order to introduce to Mrs. Carter. Well, I managed to do it without stepping on it, but I caught myself. I saw a photograph of my looking over this way. How am I going to get there in a graceful way? The other thing that that happened that was quite impressive to me is that as a Pope, I went inside the plane and greeted him on behalf of the president, and then I escorted him to the cabin door to step out onto the top of the ladder. And it was a kind of a drizzly day, cloudy and a little bit rainy in Boston there at the airport, and the Pope looked out in the distance and looked at the people down below, and he said these words that really threw me. He said, America, America, it's a strange country. Can you imagine? I mean, the reaction on me was, what does he mean? And even the Archbishop of Boston, you know, who was his official there in Boston, said to him, it'll be all right, Your Holiness, once you're on the ground. Later on, as I thought about those words, I thought what he really meant, he was doing a literal translation, and what he meant was, it's a unique country, different in a whole tradition of democracy and freedom from the very beginning. I think that that's what he was referring to. But at that moment, you know, both the Archbishop and I, who were standing side by on each of his sides, were thrown for a loop. And I hadn't been on the job for 1 month, so you can imagine hearing that. Yes, whenever a president travels abroad, the chief protocol also accompanies. He's part of the official party because he's also advising the president and helping with any protocol issues that come up during these visits. And we work, and actually the chief protocol, as well as a group of people from the White House staff, the Secret Service, even some members, other members of the Department of State, make an advance trip for every state visit, and to negotiate the schedule that is going to be followed by the president. And sometimes it's not so easy. For example, we went to Spain. You know, in Spain, you don't have dinner till 9-10 o'clock at night. You don't begin an event. And President Carter had a tradition, a custom of going to bed early. I understand President George W. Bush also at 10 o'clock, you know, he would depart. And so we had to negotiate with the Spaniards that what eventually became a state luncheon instead of a state dinner, because they wouldn't start a state dinner before 9 or 10 o'clock. And so we changed it to a luncheon, a formal luncheon at the palace, and all went very well. Getting back to the Pope, we also had the pleasure of visiting the Vatican with the president on a European tour. One of our stops was at the Vatican, and we arrived by helicopter, flying from the American ambassador's residence to the Vatican via helicopter. And that was quite a scene. And accompanying us, of course, with the Secretary of State, Secretary Edmund Muskie, and the National Security Advisor, Zbigniew Brzezinski, both of whom were Polish Americans, going in to visit a Polish Pope. That was quite historic and dramatic. Well, I don't think they actually used words, but you could tell by the excitement. They were flying with us in the helicopter that they were very excited about this opportunity to meet the Pope, whom they had already met when he came to Washington, but to meet him in his private apartment in the Vatican. It was very, very moving for them, as was for all of us. He and the Pope got along famously. They were very, they had very good conversations and a high degree of respect for each other. Because the Vatican plays a very important role in diplomatic relations around the world. I mean, they have, well, a great constituency to start with, but they have a lot of moral power, and they use it for good. And many a time, I know that our government has called on the Vatican to intervene, to help in some diplomatic conflict. So they're very important players in the international scene. President Carter is still an outstanding, brilliant man, amazing talent and intelligence, knowledge, and coming from a small town in Georgia, and having served in the Navy and been always a voracious reader and great interest in the world. It was a pleasure and a great honor to serve President Carter. I wish he'd had the chance for a second term, because I think he would have done extremely well and made many more contributions. Of course, his achievement of the Panama Canal treaties and of the Camp David Accords were tremendous achievements for our country. And he had the unfortunate luck of inheriting a bad economy, an economy that was suffering and was not able to make the progress he wanted to make. And that made it impossible for him to be reelected. Well, I think it changes through the experience of serving directly with the Commander-in-Chief, the President of the United States, in a setting that is historical. The history of the country is right there. Every president but George Washington has lived in the White House and worked from the White House. So you're at the epicenter of the heart of the country and of its history. And the people you meet are some of the most important people from our country and from around the world. So that makes a great impact on a young officer. Many of the officers went on to distinguished careers in the military service. In my case, I was doing my military service. I volunteered to serve, but I wanted to serve and then continue on with my other plans for a legal career, and so did some of my other colleagues who went into politics or education or communications. But so you have some people who are career people who graduated from West Point or the Naval Academy, and then you have others like myself who graduated from a state university. In my case, it happens to also be a full-time military school. We have a Corps of Cadets. It's very similar to the Naval Academy and the military academies. But so you have some people that continue on afterwards in other military positions and achieve very high ranks. We've had a number who have become generals and admirals, in addition to those who have distinguished themselves in the civilian sector. Getting back to the military social aides, it is, again, a position of honor. It has a lot of history and tradition in the life of the White House and the life of presidents. And I just wanted to mention two people who also were very well known, went on to very distinguished careers. One was General Douglas MacArthur, who was a military aide to Teddy Roosevelt when he was a lieutenant based here in Washington. And he served for 1 year as a military social aide. The other one was Meriwether Lewis, who was a captain in the Army when President Jefferson asked him to serve as his personal secretary at the White House, basically his assistant, prior to sending him to lead the journey through the Louisiana Purchase, the exploration and discovery journey that he did with William Rogers, and it became a very important event in our history, subsequent to our purchasing the Louisiana Purchase from France. And in my time, we had my colleagues, we included Chuck Robb, who went on to become Lieutenant Governor and Governor and U.S. Senator from Virginia. Alan Merton, who was President of George Mason University. Brian Lamb, the founder of C-SPAN. And so we had some really outstanding young officers who went on to very distinguished careers in politics and communications and education. And so it was truly an honor to serve with them when we were all very young at the White House.